gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother, and I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Lord, there have been times that I thought I couldn't last for long, but now I think I'm able to carry.
And so now it's 24 days since little LaMelo Parker was killed in Biloxi. Still no answers yet from the Biloxi PD. They're doing the investigation. Local paper now is also pursuing information by way of the Freedom of Information Act. We too have received, by the fact, I received a letter today from, maybe it was Biloxi PD or someone. So we, I gotta let you take a look at that and get it to our attorneys. You know, folks, let me just tell you this. This shouldn't be this difficult. It really isn't that difficult. When Officer McKeithen was killed, it wasn't that difficult. Wasn't that difficult? And it was a concerted effort on the part of every broadcaster, I would think, and every citizen to find out who killed that officer. The video was given to us almost instantaneously, bro. Of course, obviously, they were looking for the man who is alleged to have killed Officer McKeithen.
Yeah.
Investigation was very expeditious. And we all were on the lookout for that individual and anyone else, because we didn't know. Now, why is that evidence not just as important? In other words, why is it so difficult to get that evidence? I'm sorry, the evidence of LaMelo, when you're very forthcoming with the other. Now, I know there's a cross-jurisdictional thing going, and there's a reason why Biloxi is doing the investigation, is because the other agencies, the Sheriff's Department, the Gulfport PD, as well as that, the state troopers, are alleged to have had participants in the shooting. I got that. And, of course, we ask the Biloxi PD as to what was the problem, and then I think you have the video, the audio over there that basically says as much, that, you know, there's some cross-jurisdictional things, and they have to wait for the information. Look, I got you. I do understand that. But let's not play games with it now. It's been 24 days. That baby's been killed. And there's nothing here that can be exposed. Even the autopsy. Oh, you're hiding this information because what? It's not going to bring the baby back, not going to bring the father back. Just getting information on the victims. Why can't we get that? LaMelo's been buried now. To our knowledge, there was no second autopsy. I don't doubt that for those who want to cover up something, that may have been a good thing. Could result in an exhuming the body. It could. Why, you ask? I'll tell you why, because we got to have some answers here. We got to have some answers. There's a reason why this hostage is dead, and we need to know that reason. We owe it to him. When I heard that baby's cry after the shooting stopped, it said to me that baby was saying that I'm here. And somebody needs to find out what happened to me. And that's your position now. I want you to know, Biloxi PD, you got to find out. And the district attorney, Parker, you got to find out. And that doesn't mean that any heads got to roll. Doesn't mean that someone's got to be charged. If someone is responsible, then there's got to be consequences. But we don't have vigilantes here. See, vigilante rule, ladies and gentlemen, is what you had Black Wall Street, 1921. Now, I'm going to tell you, I do believe that there are individuals on the force who think that they are vigilantes. They're punishers. And I've talked to chiefs of police, several, who know this, and they try to purge their departments of people like that. I've even had one chief of police to explain how these guys are made. In some cases, law enforcement's on the street, and they're working some of the roughest areas in town. And they see the same people over and over again, and they know these folks are harming other people. They know it. And so they arrest these individuals for everything from domestic violence to attempted murder. And they go in and they bail out and they follow the process. And it is a process. You are innocent until proven guilty. But law enforcement officers see this firsthand. They see it. They walk up on the corners. They see the victims. They hear them. They smell them. And according to the chief, it becomes debilitating. We see this over and over. We know this guy did it. And the officer is convinced in some cases that this guy did it. And it may be circumstantial evidence, but evidence enough. And in some cases, some individuals even laugh in their face. Catch me if you can. It's the cat and mouse game. And some officers just get to the point whereby they feel, well, look, someone's got to stop this guy. Look, don't go calling Rip Daniels and saying, I just love Popo and all that. Look, I'm explaining to you how people who do that kind of work find themselves converting into converting from a law enforcement officer to a vigilante. And in their minds, they think they're doing what's best for the community, to rid the community of these individuals. They think it's better for them to profile whoever. Especially if they really get the bad guy. And if they can't get the bad guy, then they want to get the guy that's close to the bad guy, a guy who looks like the bad guy. I'm just sick and tired of the carnage. They're killing each other left and right, and I have to drive up and clean this mess up, and I'm just tired of it. And so, according to the chief, that fuels a certain contempt for the very people that they're sworn to protect. You know, it must be a horrible thing hating your job. It must be a horrible thing to just be. Oh, yeah. Hate your job or dread that you now have got to get back into it and you feel that you're not being effective. I guess that's the biggest thing, bro. When you feel you're not being effective, like you're just there and they just, the same old carnage over and over again is not improving. And here's a 13-year-old that killed, and here's a 9-year-old, and here's a... I mean, I could only imagine that it's probably the same in some cases for those folks who work in emergency rooms. People who work this close to life and death, you guys really got to have some serious therapy sometimes, I know. I couldn't do it. Well, I can't do it. But I can tell you right now, it would take its toll. You know, I know people who work in the medical profession, and these folks see life and death. I mean, to actually be a cardiac nurse, and everything is stat. I mean, that's as quick as you can go. And see someone on that gurney while you're working expire. and then break for lunch. And you've got someone else on that gurney again to now whose life you're trying to save. That's tough. And I think that law enforcement officers are basically in that same, they're in the life-saving business. And I think sometimes they decide that they're going to play judge and jury. And sometimes, ladies and gentlemen, I don't doubt that emergency room workers will pay God by simply saying, look, we just can't save this guy. Let's not even try. Who's next? Look, I'm empathizing with you. I'm not sympathizing. I'm empathizing with you. I get it. For the chief to explain that to me, I got that. You know, he says, Rip, I've seen guys, God-fearing guys, go to church every week, cry like babies because they just don't feel that they're being effective and they can't stop the bad guy before the bad guy be the bad guy. And then something snaps and they change and then they become the vigilante, the punisher. Oh, I'm going to arrest you. You're going to get out. But I'm going to do what the impeached Donald John suggested, and that is rough you up a bit. Unfortunately, what hangs in the balance are the innocent. In this case, it was LaMelo. I don't doubt that there were some officers after 2 hours of following Smith were pretty frustrated. This guy won't pull over. He's got the baby in the car. He used the spike strips. Now he's got 4 flat tires and he's still going. I had to take this guy out. But there's a baby in the car. Well, I'm just sick of this guy. All we're going to do is going to get away and baby could be dead by now, so. And you start justifying. I don't doubt they justified in their minds. Okay, well, do a little spin-out maneuver. There he is, like a sitting duck in the middle of the median. Frustration's there after this slow crawl of a chase. 2 hours. 200 miles. Time to end this. Look, the window's down. Okay. Well, what is that he's got? He's got a gun. Take him out. Did you shoot? I thought I heard a shot. Did you shoot? No. I thought I heard a shot. Was he shooting or were you shooting? I don't know. Which one? Which one of y'all was shooting? I didn't shoot first. Did you shoot first? Keystone cops. But we got our guy. What about the baby? Airlift him to Alabama. Stat. Folks, I do get it. I understand. But it's at that point, when you think that you're the punisher, you're the vigilante, that you stop being a cop. Stop being a cop. And another cop needs to say, whoa, George. You ain't a cop no more. You stop being a cop. Such was the case now in Tacoma, Washington. Last year this time, yet another African-American male, Emmanuel Ellis, is begging to breathe. I'll be damned. That just really, it teased me off hearing it. This guy just coming from rehearsing. He's a drummer in a church. Don't know how it happened, but guess what? It happened. He's begging 2 white guys and an Asian guy for breath. And all of that is symbolic for me. All you want to do is breathe. Now, listen to me. Hang on. I'm a hard swerve here, folks. I'm just going to talk to you like an African-American who survived Jim Crow and one of the first classes of integration. Now, just listen to me. This is so symbolic, the whole George Floyd thing, even going back to the Gordon there in New York. I mean, time and time again, some African-Americans saying he just wants to breathe. Now, listen to me. Now, that's symbolic. Because I'm going to get into Wall Street and you'll understand. African-Americans grabbed freedom like you would not believe. And they wanted to breathe. built all kinds of stuff. I'm telling you, it was segregated. There's no doubt about that, but them Negroes were wanting for nothing. I was one of them, right there on Nixon Street, by way of by Augusta. As a six-year-old, I can get on my bicycle and ride on those oyster shells all the way to Main Street, knowing Main Street, that was everything I needed right there. I'm not kidding. From Dr. Kyle's office to Pooh Hall, to Smith's Bakery, the Gay Paris, that was the Blue Note before it became the Blue Note. Every grocery store was right there. Mr. Miles' store was there on the corner there. And Brothers Grocery was there. Cab Company, Kemp Cab, the gas station sitting right at Nixon Street, Division Street, Mortuary just on the corner. Dr. Gibbon R. Mason's office is right there on Nixon Street and Division Street. Yeah, it didn't have to go anywhere. The USO was sitting right there, the black one. Everything right there. The Harlem Theater was right there. Just wanted to breathe. Negroes were breathing. Just wanted to breathe in this damn country. And then along, because we were breathing so very well, really, inhaling and exhaling, then there are those who got pissed off and thought that every breath should be theirs. How dare you breathe around me? I don't breathe like that. They must be doing pretty good over there. Very symbolic. Very symbolic. I'm not saying this because of trying to give you some kind of guilt complex or say I'm that's a victim. No, that's not what I'm talking about. What I'm doing is describing why there are those of us who can say, no, I'm going to breathe now. I'm going to breathe. I'm not going to put myself in that position. You better not raise that knee. Not around me. It's going to come to that. It came to that incredible day in Greenwood, just outside of Tulsa. Those Negroes were breathing 35 blocks of wealth. You hear me, Ro? 35 solid blocks. They ain't have to go to Tulsa for a damn thing. Tulsa didn't want them there anyway. And they felt that economically, I don't mind telling you. Them brothers and sisters came out of bondage. I'm sorry. Excuse me. Retract that. Those brothers and sisters fought their way out of bondage. Started that incredible city. You hear me? You see, the Greenwood was started by individuals, many of which were in the U.S. Colored Troops. That's where it all started. Yeah. See, Oklahoma was kind of a, slave state, free state. It wasn't part of the solid South, let's put it that way. And kind of border state, let's put it that way. And there's a lot of things that was happening. You know, after the Civil War, African Americans just wanted to get up out of here. And there's some here in Mississippi, because Mississippi was majority black then, end quote. But there were so many others wanted to get out in the Midwest, and they did. And what really fueled that was the U.S. colored troops, because the cavalrymen, African-American cavalrymen, were then sent out west for the so-called Indian Wars. You got me? Out around Oklahoma, Kansas. Now, needless to say, there's no doubt about, you know, Kansonians, black folks who were there fighting and participating even in the Civil War. They were militias, you know, African-Americans, I mean, that really, I'm not talking 1862 here, but it was after then that when African-Americans, U.S. colored troops, were sent out from the South. Now, we're going past Reconstruction here. We're going, you know, when Lincoln was killed, Johnson took over, and he just really wanted to really pull back in the Confederates. But that's no joke. It's true. And what the Confederates wanted was to get those Negroes in uniform out of those cities like New Orleans, stop them from patrolling. Because them brothers was not having it. It was martial law. Ultimately, somewhere between 1873, 1880, the troops were withdrawn. It was negotiated politically. And many of those African American troops found themselves in the so-called Indian Wars. The 9th and 10th Cavalry were formed, black cavalrymen. And they were good. But my point is that they became aware of that midsection in and around Tulsa and, you know, areas like that, Nebraska, you know, places that normally you just didn't see Negroes, you saw Negroes. The cowboys were born. Just saying. And then, of course, they settled. Couldn't settle in town in Tulsa, so therefore they made their own town, and that was Greenwood. Just wanted to breathe. That's all. Take a real deep breath. Inhale, exhale. You're about to hear probably something you hadn't heard before. I know that CNN's doing a piece of, what, Monday? Dreamland or something like that?
Yes, Monday at 7 or 8. Let me make sure.
Yeah. Well, I had my folks here to do some research here. Serious research. Actually, figure out what happened on the ground. You can't just go, oh, yeah, it was a massacre. Listen to me. Whenever you say that to descendants of those people, it implies that, you know, Negroes were just picking cotton and then all of a sudden they were killed. Every time you hear the history of black folks, it's always, oh, yeah, they poor things. Look at them. They just mowed down. You don't hear the victories. Do you know, I talked about Palestinians and so forth and kicking ant piles and so forth. Let me just explain this to you. For an underdog, he wins when he survives. You understand what I'm saying? I know what you're saying. You say, okay, well, look, it was a massacre. Well, yeah, there was a whole lot of black folks killed. And there was a whole lot of white folks killed. But they survived. We heard from three survivors just the other day. One 100 years old, the other one was 107, 106 years old. See, that's what goes through the mind of an underdog. The Palestinians are thinking, they'll go out and they'll do the parades and they're going rah, rah, rah. Why? I tell you why. Because the big bad Zionists, notice I didn't say Israelis, the big bad Zionists didn't wipe them out. They had 2 million people in a 140-mile radius, and they're still there. It's like that ant biting you. He's not trying to eat you. He's just trying to survive. And so if he's able to bite you and still live, good day for the ant. The only being, look, folks, you know, there are those who think that because, look, if the Minutemen thought that way about King George, we wouldn't have a country. You do get that, right? You know, before George Washington took over the Continental Army, you realize that it was all about guerrilla warfare. You know, when you have nothing to lose. When someone can take your life, you know. In other words, folks in Greenwood knew they couldn't go to the cops. And the cops not going to save them. Well, one did. I'll tell you about him in a minute. But when you survive, and this is what I want black folks to get, in quotes. When you survive, you win. This whole idea, yeah, well, they killed and they wiped out and broke bros. We won't have no Rosewood. We won't have them over here. There were a whole lot of situations like this because African Americans were breathing pretty good. Even in Louisiana. In New Orleans. All the way to Cape Town, South Africa, to be quite frank. Whole districts were uprooted because someone was breathing too well, let's put it that way. So what you had here in Wall Street, in Greenwood, was a thriving community. Tulsa, not so much. Now, you got to understand what we... Let me set this up for you. You realize we're coming on the heels of World War I. So first you had Greenwood being started, U.S. colored troops, armed military men, building their cities, their factories, their homes, not going back to the South. And then, so that's 1865, the war was over. By the time we get to the early 1900s, around 1917, Things are going pretty rocky for the rest of the world, and the World War One is happening. Being that tomorrow's Memorial Day, you've got to understand these fighting men, and you need to study them. Because I don't think there's any group of people that have sacrificed so much for freedom and didn't receive it than black folks. Black men especially. And we're still here. So here you have now, coming up on Wall Street, now you've had now 50 years that grew. You realize there was no Greenwood. 1865. Yeah, a few houses here and there. But after the Civil War and these brothers come out and they went out in the West and they started building stuff and didn't stop. Now the oil fields opened up. And when I say Wall Street, I do mean Wall Street. There were insurance companies. There were some stocks being bought and sold. Very real. Real estate companies. Not just barbershops and beauty shops here. They were a thriving community. Even medical facilities there in Greenwood. Because after all, it was segregated, and the Tulsa general didn't want them there. So, World War One breaks out, and many of those men, their descendants who were in the U.S. Colored Troops, and with the 9th and 10th Cavalry and other military folks who were out west, sent their children off, their men off to World War One. Couldn't wait to get in it. Fight men. Yeah. We going over there. We going to take it to the Germans. Adolf wasn't. He was in the military, but he didn't come to power to World War II. And they did. Of course, needless to say, many of the United States military didn't want the, still segregated, didn't want those Negroes up there, elbow to elbow. With the other white soldiers, didn't want to show them up. So therefore, you had African Americans fighting under French flags. But fight they could, because they liked to fight. Listen to me. There is no doubt about the fact that inside of every black man, there's a certain rage that says, I want to kick some ass. Now you might, oh, really? I don't know where it comes from. Is it in you, bro?
Yeah.
Is it in me, too? That doesn't mean you act on it all the time, but it's just, trust me on this.
It's there.
Just right below the surface. It's right below the surface.
Don't play with it.
So these men go off to World War One. And they learn about more stuff and bring some stuff back, start doing tailor-made suits. Oh, it was a connection. I don't know if you realize this, but there was after World War One, there was a connection between Black Wall Street, Greenwood, and France. And a lot of it was born out of the French clothes, the French women, and the music. French loved these guys. The Harlem Hellfighters were, they got the Croix de Gras, the top honor there in World War One. Listen to me. And there was a direct connection. I mean, there was some importing and exporting. So here we go. 1921 comes. War ends. These men come back with their carbines. Because at that time, ladies and gentlemen, you brought your weapons back. You even brought back some weapons that souvenirs, as they would say. You're talking about a pretty well-armed Greenwood, Oklahoma. Them brothers were more than capable and very, very well trained in how to win a war. Or at least how to fight to a stalemate, and that's exactly what happened. I can take you to the details of where it came from and how. But when you start thinking about a massacre, I want you to understand, ladies and gentlemen, don't go having some, don't cry on me. Because had it not been for air power, trust me on this, Black Wall Street wouldn't have happened. It took 18 hours. Listen to me. It took 18 hours for the carnage to stop. The battle to end. How did it start? Well, let me tell you. It started in an elevator, actually. There was a young man by the name of Dick Rollin. He was a shoe shiner. He got on an elevator at the Drexel building. And it's right there at the corner of Main Street. There was, in those days, the elevators didn't operate by themselves. You had to have an operator. In this case, it was a female. Rollin wanted to go to the colored restroom, and the colored restroom was upstairs. That's not unusual. It was also that way in Broomfields. Broomfields was on Howard Avenue. Had one also on Highway 49, 25th Avenue. By the way, you know, you keep up with these things. And so he went upstairs, and it seemingly that he knew the attendant. And she was 17 years old. Well, Sarah Page was her name. She's 17 years old. He of course, was 19 years old. They knew each other. It wasn't integrated. But I got to tell you, always in the South, or even during segregation, you always were an integrated environment. You had a caste system. There were certain things that blacks could do and certain things white could do. And never the two shall meet. So he got off the elevator, and someone implied that somehow or another, the lady, Sarah, was assaulted. Never once said she was. More than likely, it is said by the locals there that some Caucasian got on thereafter and was a little bit jealous over how friendly. He was a little jealous over how friendly Dick Rollin was and how Sarah was sucking it up. Hey, Sarah never complained. So, that one bigot, inferiorist, impotent, whatever you want to call him. Usually it's that's how it goes. He goes out and he spreads the word. Oh, yeah, look, I think that boy is trying to assault that Mart girl. Dick Rollin, being 19 years old and understanding the lay of the land, said, I ain't do nothing, man. I got to get up out of here. So he did what any other young 19-year-old would do in those days. Well, ran for cover. Went back to Greenwood. Went back to Greenwood to see, well, his daddy. His daddy? Who was his daddy? His daddy was one of those doggone World War I fighters. Hey, Dad, you know, they say that I had something to do with this white girl. I ain't had nothing to do with this white girl. Come on in, boy. It's all right. We'll get to the bottom of it. You see, during those days, ladies and gentlemen, African-American men had different locals. They had all kinds of small organizations, like the Knights of Pithas, the Knights of, well, of course, you had the Shriners, you had the Masons. Then you had the other little social clubs, the Boom Booms, the Loom Looms, the Lynx, the this, the that, the this. And then you had, inside of the church, you had the deacons for this and the this, the pharaohs for that. There were all kinds of little black organizations. And all of them, ladies and gentlemen, had a network going. Men organizations, female organizations. And there are those, and you should talk to us, who know exactly what I'm talking about. I mean, it wasn't just the Elks. Oh, no. You had a lot of benevolent organizations, but in many cases, these organizations, gun-toting organizations, men who were being men who did not apologize for it either. They knew what they were involved with, these men who just came out of World War I. You see, ladies and gentlemen, it was in 1915 that D.W. Griffith came up with a movie that changed the face of this nation. It was indeed a birth of a nation. The nation of the Ku Klux Klan. It was. And in 1919, the Woodrow Wilson played that movie in the Capitol. That same year, getting down toward the end of World War I, 250,000 Klansmen marched down Pennsylvania Avenue. Do you know that the Klan didn't even burn a cross until after that movie? That wasn't their branding. It was D.W. Griffith who came up with that. Singing around the cross. Why it burned. And ever since that time, voila, there was a newfound generation of the Klan. And so, ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you, the Klan showed up on May 30th, 1921. I'll tell you about this running battle when I come back.
Start your morning fresh with Wendy's $3 classic breakfast.